explain a bit the history of this seminar. The idea, so this is basically, it's not something in which I will explain part of my own research work, but basically I will describe two papers that appeared last year in Science. And why those papers? The history is that we have some collaboration with people in the Biomedical Institute of the Medical Research Institute of the city in Madrid. And Raul and myself have some collaboration there. And there was one of our collaborators came to one of those papers, and he was really, really excited about that. He essentially thought, okay, we are going to analyze experimental data from molecular biology, and then we are going to discover all the laws of molecular biology and biochemistry. And the reason why is that the statements in this paper, in the two papers, were really strong. For example, he says, without any prior knowledge about physics, kinematics, or geometry, the algorithm discovered Hamiltonians, Lagrangians, and laws of geometric and momentum conservation. So this is a paper in which the authors, they say they discovered natural laws from experimental data without prior knowledge of nothing. And also then in this other paper, there is a robot scientist. So finally, those papers were explaining the way to, without knowing nothing about science, just having some machines the machines will work for you and discover all the laws, you know. Okay, well, if you read the abstract of the papers just fast. And then, okay, this talk was given in this Biomedical Research Institute just to, well, then in the talk, I will repeat this, hear this talk. So I will describe the papers, which are in fact are quite interesting. I think it's nice to know about them. But then I will make some comments. And the comments that, unfortunately, or fortunately, I don't know, it depends on your taste, we are very far from having no necessity to learn science for doing it. So still we are, the titles I will say are too ambitious. I don't describe really what is on. But okay, let's see how I will describe this. Just the motivation, then describing the two papers. And then, well, this is the only part of original research. In fact, it's not my own research. This was done a long time ago with Cristóbal López in his thesis. But I will describe this because it's the methods are the same that were used by these people to discover laws. And then this will be the philosophical part. I will talk blah 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 about the philosophy of this. And then this will, in fact, as you see, this more than a research talk is something. I will open a discussion. Then I will be glad if people make comments at the end if you agree with my view or not, we can talk a little bit about if it's possible to automatize the science or finding natural laws just from data. So let's go. This is the first paper, the paper in which these people described Adam, the robot scientist. So this is Adam. This is 1 meter, so it's a big thing. So what is this thing? What is this robot? You can have a look at the monster in action. So this robot is a device with many arms and things that it opens a fridge, takes samples of yeast. This is a biological scientist. So it's analyzing yeast properties. So it's doing things. It's doing experiments with the yeast. So it's putting chemicals, putting things on it, and then incubating and moving the things around. So it's doing stuff, heating, cooling, measuring things. So it's something like an optical reader. Okay, so it's doing this kind of stuff. Okay, and they call this a road scientist. So what is really, what is, there are many videos in this, if you are interested, it's fine to, there are several videos in this, this web page. So what is this? Adam is a fully, Adam, the name is it's supposed to be an acronym, but they put Adam because it's the first computer science, if it's robot scientist. It's supposed to be. I don't know what will happen with when Cain comes. Anyway, so it's a laboratory to perform one kind of task, recording growth curves of different strains of yeast. So it has yeast in several strains, so it has mutants of these organisms, of yeast. Mutants also, it has many samples in which one gene has been modified and many other samples in which another gene has been modified, so thousands of modifications, mutants of yeast. And also has a different media to make it grow. So it has several metabolites, several things to control the thing. And then it has a computer with some artificial intelligence. Essentially, it has several databases. I will explain a little bit. And then the task of this robot, the research program of this robot, is to find, in yeast metabolites, there are many enzymes, there are lots of enzymes, which make the metabolism work, but some of them, people, scientists know which genes codify for those enzymes, which genes produce those enzymes, and some of the enzymes are called orphans, so they, scientists don't know which genes produce such such enzymes. So the task of this robot is to locate, to identify the genes codifying for those orphan enzymes. This has some artificial intelligence on it, and it plans experiments for checking the hypothesis and performs them. So in this sense, it's like a scientist doing some hypothesis, testing them by experimental programs. It's doing only one kind of research, but it's fast. So it's much faster than some student, for example. And, okay. What is the database, the kind of knowledge that Adam has? I am not an expert in biochemistry or in molecular biology, so I will describe very, very fast this, but essentially it has a model, a graphical model of yeast metabolism. Essentially the kind of graphical model is that, okay, there is this metabolite, or this substance in the cell, in this cell, this other, and people know that this enzyme is catalyzes the transformation of this metabolite into this metabolite, or this enzyme transforms this metabolite into this metabolite. So this is the kind of thing biology is now. So the enzymes which catalyze several pathways in this metabolism, and this is what the computer has in its. This is the part of the knowledge of the computer controlling Adam. So there is no knowledge about the rates at which this occurs. It's just this enzyme is involved in this process. That says nothing about the speed or efficiency, but it's involved in this process. And also, in addition to this, has some database which is called KeyGG, which essentially has a list of genes in many species, specifying which in this species this gene codifies this enzyme. Okay, so it has many enzymes on this. So this is the knowledge that Adam has, and then so it has a methodology to formulate hypotheses and later to check them. Essentially, the thinking of the robot is the following. You have several enzymes which are orphans. You don't know which gene is codifying for them. And then you look in the metabolism. Okay, this enzyme is affecting this and this. So the robot can measure these endpoint metabolites. The robot can measure this. So let's select some enzyme which has some effect. So the presence or absence of this enzyme has effect on this metabolite. So absence of or presence of this will have. I can measure, because I know if this is present or not. And then, find, so, the robot selects the enzyme and then find what is called the EC enzyme class. Essentially, this enzyme is of this type, and then looks in the database which other enzymes in this class are in other organisms, and if in the other organisms people know which kind of gene codifies for this protein. A similar enzyme in this other organism has already discovered from which gene it comes in this other organism, and then looks also in the databases which genes in yeast are similar to the genes in other species. So it's just looking for similarities between the enzymes and the genes in different species. And then, the robot finds a candidate gene. So this gene is similar to the gene which in other species codifies for an enzyme which is similar to the one I'm looking for. Then the hypothesis is, okay, this gene is codifying for my enzyme. And then this is the hypothesis. Then for testing, it plans experiments. So if I use a mutant in which this gene is inactivated, then I should not. So if this gene is activated, the enzyme should not be there, and then this metabolite will not appear. This is the hypothesis. Let's see if this is true. And then this is what the robot was doing. Testing thousands of hypotheses of this type. And then the robot rejects or kills hypotheses depending if it's successful or not. So this is the plan, and the robot was working hard, and he found the following. But what is reported in science? So in the page, what there are things which are later. But in the what was described in the paper in science, that the robot checked for 13 orphan enzymes, it formulated 20 hypotheses, and 12 of them were confirmed. So the robot located 12 enzymes from the 13 it was looking for. After revision of the literature, 6 were already discovered. So it has discovered 6 new genes codifying for enzymes. And also identified an error in the bioinformatics that this has used. So this is the kind of things the robot discovered. It has not very exciting for us, but seems to be useful this kind of genes codified for this enzyme. So this is the description of Adam. And it's a philosophical question to say, is this really a scientist or not? But in fact, he or she or it is doing what many biological master students are doing, or even higher. So it's doing something which is called doing science. But this is strongly constrained by the kind of knowledge it has. It has not many, that's a very restricted knowledge. And also this knowledge remains essentially fixed. He fixed one error in the database, but essentially the knowledge it has is quite static. It's not improved with experiments. This is Adam. I will describe the second paper, which is mining natural laws from experimental data. And this, the best thing now is to let a video by the authors to describe the things regarding Cornell. Essentially, they built several apparatus, essentially oscillators, harmonic oscillators and chaotic detector. But this is a double harmonic oscillator. Okay, this is, and then they measure the position of this. And okay, this is the position. And then they run some algorithm, and the algorithm is what will appear now. Okay, I will explain what is this later, but at the end they say that they find, but essentially they detected some equation. I will not say some equation describing this function. It's clearer in the second case. This case, this is a double pendulum, you know this, it's a chaotic pendulum, and then they measure the angles, two angles describing the position of this. And again, they run some algorithm. Well, this is the trajectories of the two points. They run some algorithm that you describe a little bit later. And the they found, say, the Hamiltonian of the system. This is the energy of the system. Okay, this is what they found. I will describe a little bit more in detail how are they doing that and what are they really discovering. So they apply this to several simple mass with two springs or a double harmonic oscillators and the chaotic pendulum, and then they say they discovered the Hamiltonian of the system in all cases, the equation of motion, so this is acceleration equal to something in terms of position and velocity. Circular manifold say that they discovered something which is trivial but has not for a machine, is that the position x and y of this pendulum was in a circle. The algorithm discovered this, and okay, Hamiltonian of the double pendulum. So they discovered several things that, say, without attending some classical mechanics courses, so by just looking at the data. So how did they do that? So the algorithm was to learn loss from data was based on genetic algorithms. So genetic algorithms are search and optimization algorithms based on the mechanism of biological evolution. They are used in many places in machine learning applications, in many, especially in the engineering side. And they work like this. See, I will describe as applied to this particular case. Essentially, what the method and what the people did is to generate an initial population of many, many random formulas. So the acceleration is the position to the square divided by the velocity multiplied by something plus 3 or something. So it's a random formula. There are other ones involving all the variables. You make a large set of those crazy formulas.
But keeping the units?
I think they keep the units. But this is just putting a number in front of it. We fix the units. Promise on the idea to keep the units. Right. Essentially, it's more important to keep the mathematical consistency. I mean, so it's something divided by, and the formula cannot stop there. So you divide by something. So the consistency of the formula is more important. Anyway, so some random formulas. And then the idea is to let this population evolve as in a biological population, trying to fit better the data. Essentially, is try to see if this formula describes the data well. So the acceleration is a function of velocity and positions and all that. My formula, so this is the formula. I have the experiment, the positions and the velocities and all that. It's the formula explaining well the data. And so you give a number of fitness value. So the best formula has a higher fitness, they have a higher score, and the bad formulas have a very low score. Initially, all the formulas are very bad. But what you do is copy the best formulas, even if they are quite bad, the less bad of them, you copy them. So you reproduce them, make copies of them. The bad ones, you kill them. Yeah, you delete them from the memory of your computer. And then create new formulas by slight mutations of the old ones. So let's change this formula a little bit. Instead of a multiplication, let's put a minus sign or let's put something else. Or let's change, if this was acceleration, let's change acceleration and velocity. Or let's do changes on it, mutations. Or, and also, crossover, so the idea of sexual reproduction. So you have a formula which is there. And a formula, so you have two formulas, and then let's put a piece of this formula into the other, and a piece of the other into the other. You keep the old ones and the new ones, and see if the thing has improved.
The mutations is in the operations, or also
in the value? In
so the 0.5 to 0.6 as a mutation, yeah. Or they don't feed that?
So the numbers can be mutated, yeah.
But they are not fed by less squares or something like that? So you, when you have a formula, you have your data, you feed them to the best, less the squares or something.
Well, it's not, well, not a fit, you don't fit them. You have a formula, and you evaluate, for example, what is the distance and the mean square distance of this formula to your data, and this gives a number. You don't think, you just keep the square.
Okay.
And then you kill the bad ones and keep the best ones, and then try to improve.
Okay.
So by improving them, if they really improve, you keep them and kill the old ones. But the, and if it doesn't help, you keep the old ones which are better. So you try to do this again and again and again. And finally, by construction, the population can only improve. And, okay, but and repeating this this process again and again by artificial selection, you are getting better and better formulas. This is a bit, it's a quite old, it's from the 70s, it's an idea from the 70s.
And with this method, you can always reach a solution which is good enough. I mean, maybe you can be trapped.
You don't know what, from a
standpoint. So you have no.
You are doing, and you know that you will be improving. How fast?
Or staying.
You cannot be.
If you apply this to the three-body problem, which doesn't have closed solutions, you can read the.
I will show you.
And you will. I mean, you can reach approximate solutions, but.
Yeah. You will obtain formulas that describe the two data better than random ones.
Yeah.
That's true. Yes, there are a couple of technical things I think are interesting for the audience here. For example, how do you store the formula in the computer? There are several ways, but I think this is the kind of plots you saw in the movies. Essentially, this is this formula, a convenient way of storing it on the computer is this way. So it means that you have 2 and a, you multiply them, 2a, so it's this thing, then make the square root, then minus b, so you take b, this result and minus, then divide by the result of multiplying 2 times A, mm-hmm. So this is the way you, so you codify formulas by networks, in fact by acyclical directed graphs. This is what you, so in this sense, what you have on the computer is a population of graphs, a population of networks. So it's interesting for people here working on networks and evolution of networks, perhaps, so it's doing something which is not far from what these people is doing, but for a different means. Okay, this is a way of codifying this formula, which is the root of the second order algebraic equations, like this. So b squared minus the result of this, which is 2 times 2 times a times c, so this is this factor, minus, then the square root, then minus b plus, and then divided by 2a. So this is the kind of the way. So putting networks on a computer is a way of codifying formulas. And
can you have a closed loop?
You can, let's see, you can have the same, you can have closed loops, but it's as if you have a sense to the loops, is then you don't have a cyclical, unless you have some recurrence formula, which I think is not allowed here. But instead of B and B, you can have B and then a cycle that will multiply B times this. So you can have a cycle that always you have to have a sense in order to arrive somewhere. Unless you want to implement recurrence, that I don't know if you really can have this context or not. Okay, this is the way of putting networks on formulas on the computer, or at least one way, a convenient way. And also, what questions about mutations? So mutations are, for example, from this formula, which is this, from this formula, you can change the 2, you change it to a, or you can change a minus into plus. So these kind of things you can do. All the elements of the formula can be changed. And also the numbers, instead of 2, you can put a different number. And the crossover, you have 2 formulas, then you can interchange this piece of the formula and this piece of the formula, and interchange it, so in a kind of sexual reproduction, and then this is the result. Then you evaluate if this is better or worse than before. It's better to keep it and delete the other ones, and if it's worse, you delete the new ones. This way you have better and better formulas to describe the data. I was telling that this is no idea, so what is new in this paper on science? Essentially, they they have to improve things. One is that they try to find conserved quantities. So instead, I will show an example in which most rational ways to find equations of motion. And instead of equation of motion, they focus more on conserved quantities. And for the kind of systems they considered, this was quite successful. And the other ones to assign a good score to the different formulas, which is better, but they use some combination of derivatives that apparently was quite efficient in this case. So this was the novelty. But the method of improving formulas by this kind of artificial selection is a quite old one. For example, I will show a couple of examples. This is our friend Alberto Álvarez. We work with him, and for example, by building random formulas, he built several examples of application of genetic algorithms to prediction process. And this is the line is the acceleration in the hand of a Parkinson patient, so it's the tremor of the Parkinson measured with an accelerometer. I don't know if this is the position of the acceleration, sorry, I don't remember. But essentially, by this method, he finds a recurrence that if you know the position of the hand of this patient one time before, three times before, and two times before, so you have data on three times, you can predict the fourth one by this formula, and the dots are the results of the formula. So it's perfect. So if you know three consecutive positions of the hand of the patient, you know perfectly what is the next one. So you discover the law of the motion of this patient just from the data. Also, this is from the thesis of Cristóbal. We did something like this some time ago. So trying to predict, in this case, this is the temperature of the surface of the Alboran Sea. So this is the Gibraltar, this is the Spain, Africa, and the colors are different temperatures in the sea. And then we have here, at each point, we have the temperature of the sea. So this image is 415, so you have 10 to the 5 points here, and each point is a time series. So we try to predict this sequence of images. And the method was exactly this, was a genetic algorithm, but since we don't have a single time series, that we have 10 to the 5, something else should be done. And there was some pre-processing in that. And so it's extracting from the images the most relevant configurations. The first one is the mean, so this is the mean, the temporal mean of the temperature, and also what is called the empirical orthogonal eigenfunctions of the principal components. So it's essentially trying some optimal way of giving a sequence of data or a sequence of images. How can you recover the sequence by linearly combining a basis multiplied by coefficients? So you have several elements of a basis, multiply them by coefficients, and sum them, and then this sequence approximates the original one. What should be the basis, so the set of images you do in this comparison, in order to have the optimal representation of the original one with a finite number of basis elements? I want to represent this 10 to the 5 time series only by 3 time series, then which 3 images should I combine with different coefficients so that the just moving 3 numbers, the numbers in front of those images, this sum is as close as possible to the original one. And the mathematical answer to this is the principal component analysis. And this, okay, these are the 3 components which are most present in this time series. And this is the motion of this time series. So you make this pattern to go up and down in this way, this pattern to go up and down in this way, this pattern to go up and down in this way, and you sum the 3 things, you get something which is very close to the original one.
Sure. Does it give a singular value of decomposition, such images?
This method has lots of names. Singular value decomposition is a name given to a method to obtain something like eigenvalues of matrices which are not square. something like eigen values. And the methodology to find those three things is something related to finding eigen values. So the answer is this, this is related, in fact, the variance of those time series are exactly the singular values of the original time series.
How much information do you need to get to replicate the emotion?
To replicate, I mean, for the moment I'm not predicting nothing, I'm just representing what is seen from the satellite. You need to reproduce exactly what you see from the satellite, you need 10 to the 5 time series. In order to do that, just with 3 time series, you recover, I don't know if I have the number. I don't have the number, but you recover mostly like the 18% of the variance of the series you recover with just 3 components.
What?
18 or something. Sorry, 80 or something. But depends on the case. Okay, this is the example. And this is an example. Then, once you have 3 time series, you go back to the genetic algorithm. The time series, you try to find formulas that, given a sequence of 1 or 2 or 3 previous steps, you try to predict the next one. In this case, for example, for this time series, this is the prediction. So you get, I think it's two or three from the previous, and then you get the next one, and then it's nearly perfect for this. So you are able to predict the temperature in 1 month in the time. So I think that this is in the thesis of this talk. Okay, this other time series is more complicated, but again, the predictions are in line with what is the. So you are predicting those 3 time series by building formulas via genetic algorithms. But how limitations of this thing? Well, first, it's not a limitation, but if you train one of those genetic algorithms with something which is periodic, or close to periodic, or very regular, the genetic algorithm is perfect. The series is, you get a formula which predicts perfectly this motion. When you have chaotic or turbulent motions, as are in the cases that we are the last case that I'm showing you, it's more difficult. You need lots of data and computer time to find reasonable models. In fact, this double pendulum, they say in the paper that they obtained in the Hamiltonian, and it took 2 days in a 32-core machine. Okay. So it's a heavy task. But anyway, it's something that can be done in some cases. And I think the most important thing is that short time prediction is relatively good, longer time is not so good. So this is another example we did in a paper also some time ago. This is not for the ocean, it's for a simulation of the complex visual under equation in a chaotic regime. And okay, this is the error in some units, and this is as a function of time. But this is the one time step prediction. So you have the configuration of the system, and you give information this time. A previous one, I think you go a couple or donate information 2 or 3 times before, and then you try to estimate what will be the time series in the next step. And then you have an error which is small. If you try to predict 5 time steps above, the error is growing. In fact, it's growing exponentially. If you try to predict the result of a prediction, and then this result is used for the next prediction, and then this result is used for the next prediction, the error grows exponentially. So, sure, you are trying only to predict the next time. Those methods work a little better. If you want more, then things are more tricky. Well, it's very interesting to talk about this in the context of predictability, noise, and all this, but this will take us too long. Just a comment is that in the cases in which the people in the writing science did the experiment, did the example, they found the Hamiltonian. and they focus, they don't really focus in the prediction in time, but in some conserved quantities, some global conserved quantities. But I don't know if you know or not, but in chaotic systems, so the free body problems that what Poincaré showed long time ago is that there are only a very few, I think, I don't know, five, or there are very few conserved quantities, conserved regular quantities. And all the, so you don't have conserved quantities, or the conserved quantities you have, they are fractal, they are very strange, you cannot write as a formula. So you, this method can find for you Hamiltonians, angular momenta, and a few more conserved quantities. You cannot apply this to find any physical conserved law, because in chaotic systems there are not many of them. This is a limitation of this approach. More limitations. this kind of methodology. So in principle, the method works. So you want to find some prediction short term, or even if they exist, some global conserved quantities. It seems to work. It's quite good. But what are the laws you find? For example, for the Mediterranean Sea, what were the laws you find? Something like this. So this is the amplitude of one of the modes, one of the modes in which the images were decomposed, as a function of the previous this 1-3 means time minus 1, time minus 3. So you get those times in advance, you make this combination, then you get with high precision the series at the present time or the future time. But okay, is this what you call a physical law for the temperature of the ocean or temperature of the Mediterranean Sea? I would say that they are quite difficult to understand. In fact, the equations Schmidt and Lipson formed also are very difficult to understand. You understand them only if you really know Hamiltonian mechanics. And okay, this is the angular velocity, the square is something related to the kinetic energy. So if you know physics, you recognize this. But if you don't know physics before, you see something like this. So a series of symbols that really reproduces the data, but you don't understand nothing. That's the point. Yeah, or this is my point. Look that I am now in the part in which I am beginning to give my opinion. And I will, of course, you will be free also to say your opinion later. But my opinion is that this is not really a physical law. This is a way of finding regularities in the data. But finding regularities in the data is not the same as understanding. And this is just before going deeper into philosophy, just an example. This is a novel, The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. It's a funny history, and also I think there have been some movies and things like that. Well, there are many histories in this book, but one of them is that the some very advanced extraterrestrial civilization builds a supercomputer in order to answer the question of the ultimate question of life, the universe, and everything. So what's the meaning of everything? And then the computer is running lots of time trying to find the answer to the universe. And okay, finally, the computer finds the answer. And the answer is 42. And then the people the people programming the computer says, what is 42? Then the computer says, you ask me the answer to the ultimate question of life, universe, and everything, and I am the biggest supercomputer in the world, and I am sure that this is the answer, 42. And therefore, then the next step, the people went to build a bigger computer to understand what this is. Is that carrying just numbers, I think, is not the same as understanding what is happening. And I think the situation is exactly having a very good formula is not understanding, or I think it's not having the full physics or the full science of the thing. Something else is needed. This way, again, I am in reflections and I am telling my opinion, but okay, this discovering laws from data, the way this paper was describing it, is a way of, so it's It's like same way of inductivism. So you have data, and then you compress those data. You make a compressed description of that. And some people think that this is science. Rutherford called them stamp collecting. And since I was giving a talk in a biological audience, I found this text, which I think is very clear, from a, I don't know if he was biologist or biochemist, but anyway, he won the François Jacob win the Nobel Prize in physiology with Jacques Monod for discovering that enzymes affect the transcription, so the product of the genes, which are the proteins and enzymes, also feedback into the transcription of new proteins. So he won the Nobel Prize for this. And he has an autobiography started with him. And this is, in several places he described how he was learning to do science. And this is one of the paragraphs I think is quite clear. What can make possible the analysis of bacteriophage multiplications and understanding on the different stages was above all the play of hypotheses and experiments. Construction of imagination and inference that could draw from them. It started with certain conception of the system, then one designed an experiment and test another aspect of this conception. And depending on the results, the conception changed, and so on and so forth. And so, and this is how research in biology worked. Contrary to what I once thought, scientific progress did not consist simply in observing, in accumulating experimental facts, and then drawing a theory from them. It began with an intention of a possible world, or a fragment, and then comparing the real world and the experiment, and this constant dialogue between imagination and experiment is what allowed one to form a conception of what is called reality. So I think it's a nice description of this interplay between, it's not just extracting the laws from data, but also starting something from data which may be very useful. It can be very interesting, but then something else should be done to understand what is going. This should be put in some framework, in some theory, in some conceptual framework. And okay, this is, I think, enough for philosophy. Just a look and some summary. I briefly describe genetic algorithms, and also there are other techniques from artificial intelligent neural networks. There are other things which are very powerful automatic methods to compress and to accumulate observed knowledge into a very compressed form. And this is very useful, and is in fact used in control, in optimization, and design, and so in many applications is used, and this is very useful. And in fact, the fact that you have observation, this can be compressed, this is an indication that there is some law, some regularity inside. So this is the indication that there is some natural law there. But calling the natural law just the output of those algorithms, to me, it seems excessive. And only in simple, in very, very simple case, in which you already know the laws, and then you recognize that the output of the algorithm is just the laws. Now, only in this case you will call this statistical law. In other cases you will call this just a formula fitting the data. Those laws are not useless. They can provide clues to find new natural laws, for example, in focusing which motifs, which parts of formulas are repeated all the time. Then focus on this. This indicates it's the same way as Mendel, when he did the laws of heresy, he didn't just summarize the laws. Okay, this P, green P and the other P, make this. He didn't just summarize the laws. He also thought, oh, should be some gene, something which is interchanged between them. So this was data which then gave him a clue to do some kind of theory. So the extracting data. Exactly, laws from data is usable, but it's not the end. I return back to the case of Adam. Adam is not just extracting laws from data, because he had some internal knowledge, and Adam contrasted the knowledge it has with the data, and tried to make a dialogue between the two. The it was a quite limited kind of knowledge, but it was doing really formulating hypotheses and testing them. So in my opinion, this is something really more similar to what a scientist do or should do. Still in a restricted, very restricted thing, but I think this maybe can, he was doing something related to research. Let's see, I don't know if they will replace us, but not for the moment. Okay, so this is the thing I wanted to tell you, and I think we are open to discuss a little bit on that if you want.
Any comments or questions?
I mean, the genetic part, when you try to extract some laws, in general, you expect the law to be universal somehow. You cannot, you will not have a law that is only valid for one transition.
Well, in this in those examples, you do find laws which are valid for one transition. So,
and most probably that's only an approximate formula, because if you this looks like being in a potential well in which the mutation don't allow you to move much more if you are in a deep well. So it will be very difficult to have the final formula.
I think that the question is, what do you mean by a final formula? Formula is a relationship between quantities.
Yes.
And I think the important thing is, what are the quantities you measure? In the case of the pendulum, they know that they were the velocities, the positions, and the
angles. That's a lot
already. This is essentially everything. In the case of the Mediterranean, we know from physics that the important things are the fields, the field of temperature, the field of velocity, but the algorithm was not looking for them. So the algorithm was not looking for the universal laws. It was not looking for the Navier-Stokes equation. It was looking for the amplitudes of some modes and some decomposition, some time series. And this is really a case by case. So it's predicting very well this time series. But if you, instead of the Mediterranean, you look at the Pacific, will be completely different, even if you know that the laws of the motion of water are the same. But you are not looking at the variables which make the things universal. This is my idea.
Can you show again the formulas for the pendulum?
There are a couple of them.
I don't
understand what it is.
In any case, I wouldn't say that this is a lot, because you have there the Lagrangian of the Hamiltonian, but these don't depend on the mass of the pendulum because they use only one.
The only one.
So
mass. Yeah, the masses are there.
Yeah.
The masses are in this.
Yeah,
in this
but they are number. I mean, if you see that, you don't know if this is Planck constant, which is a fundamental constant of the universe, or is because the mass is 1.89. So, in this sense, this is not I wouldn't call this a law, because, I mean, well, if you do this for a lot of pendulums,
by several ones,
yes, you can. And then, the other thing that you said, I think that Adam is less a scientist than this algorithm, because what you are doing with Adam is, okay, you have a framework in which you know that there are genes that connect to enzymes, and simply don't know that. I mean, it's like having in the beginning of the 19th century the periodic table, in which there is a theory that tells you that between these two elements there should be another one, and then okay, you look for it. But the theory, and Mendeleev said, look for an element which, or the standard model, you can say. I mean, it's like, look for it because it will be there, okay? And then during the experiments and looking for it, it's not finding anything fundamental. It's just testing something which is part of some much more fundamental framework, which is the periodic table or, I don't know, the structure of matter.
I mean, this robot is not discovering the laws of molecular biology, how the DNA is combining them to produce useful proteins. It's not doing that. But I think, so it's not so ambitious. But I think it's doing something. I mean, before they didn't know this which gene produced this protein, and now they know.
Yes,
so,
but
they
know that
it's very particular.
One, that, I mean, it's, for me, it's like, It's like an overrated way of stamp collecting.
We can call it this.
It's a very expensive.
It's a massive stamp collecting.
I'm not saying that this is worthless, because if you want to study yeast, you need to know the whole network, and you have to do it, but it's a mechanical process. I mean, you know, and this is, I mean, if you speak with the biologists, they tell you, many of biologists which do these things in the lab, they say, okay, we are cheap workforce doing these repetitive things, because we need to complete all the framework, but the people that that's the scientific process of thinking about this and looking at the whole picture is the people which is in higher stages of the scientific life.
This is a low level scientific work.
Can they make you a PhD in this thing?
Yeah, because there are PhDs which are based on
I think what we do is exactly as mechanical, but instead of doing this thing, we do it with concept. But it's mechanical also. And you can do it also with the genetic algorithm. Instead of square roots and all, concepts.
I don't understand.
I mean, there is people that does it, I think. But I don't think that this is...
In principle,
everybody.
Instead of only PhD, doctor studies of DSC. Joke. Can I clarify my question? What did you mean by the higher levels that were not, this machine was not doing?
No, I mean, for example, this. I mean, if I give you a network of enzymes, you will, this machine will never discover that, for example, that genes are genes are the one that codify for enzymes. You can leave it there for the whole life of the universe and will never discover it.
Well, I think that's why it's called Adam. Adam, when we come from the history and Bible of Brown, Adam started knowing nothing, and he started to know things. And what they mean, if you get some idea from the name, is that, okay, we start from an initial information, you have some initial information before you start the process. But later on, you gather this information and you build a whole picture around it. It's not that you're going to start at the nowhere from the picture. It's you start from some point. Well, that's inevitable. We cannot just start.
No, but I don't think that. I think that what you are doing with Adam is you are giving Adam the laws, and you are telling him, okay, there is some missing data here to
fill the gaps.
Go and fill the gaps.
Well, this is what I mean.
But this is not creating a law from scratch.
Yes, this is what I mean. You cannot go and create a law from nothing. We are actually living in the law of life, right?
Yeah.
We have to have some.
What Adam does is, for me, it's not called thinking.
Well,
I mean, we know the laws because we think.
This is the thing. If you have this solutions to these answer that Adam is finding in the end, these solutions, these like concepts, like the gentleman said, to be connected together to find the real answer behind everything. I mean, the real answer nobody knows.
That suffice on by a human. I mean, you cannot. I don't think that you can do it with genetic algorithms.
Well, it's just because a matter of time.
I really don't think so. I think that in some point it's similar to the discussion between mathematicians in the beginning of the 20th century with this program to automatize
the mathematical proofs. And someone showed that
it cannot be done. Gödel showed that it cannot be done. Simply because the logical structure of mathematics doesn't allow it. So, and I think that with this, okay, maybe you can do it if you have infinite time and then test all the possible laws. But I don't think that if you leave the most advanced and fast machine in the world with all the data, we'll discover, quantum mechanics. At least not doing it in this way. If it learns to think in some more refined way, it can be, but not just by testing things randomly.
What Adam is doing, or what you are discussing, is particularly the technical part, but I think the important part to
is not really that one alone. It's the discussion we can do from the Reddit team. And it would be very interesting if Adam would be capable to say to his inventor, you gave me those, but some of them are wrong.
In one case, it was one of the things in database was wrong.
He said that one of the points of the previous data was
one of the annotation of the genes. Sorry, was written that this gene qualifies for this, and he said no, this is not true.
Or even better,
one of the points of the data is not a law that is wrong.
One of the things that the teacher taught him, he discovered that this was not true.
But what I mean is that Adam will never invent a new method to do what he's doing. He will never invent a new experiment.
The key point is the following. Adam was instructed that he can doubt on the data points that was given to him. Because if he was instructed, those are the data points, and now you have an algorithm, and it deduces that one is wrong, now there's a bias. If it is instructed to first test all of the data points that you already have, of course, during the test, you can turn out that one of them is wrong. So the question is, if this is part of the job given to him,
I don't know the way it was around.
Or this is something that it comes out after an inference that it turns out that one of the data points was missing because it didn't match with other results, but not because you were checking explicitly those data points. That's the difference.
Do we continue outside?
Yeah.